Yesterday we were looking at how to turn a continuous time signal into a discrete time signal. I mean, that's a little bit of a misleading description in that the output of your circuit is still a continuous time signal, except that the values depend only on the input continuous time signal at discrete instants of time. This is what I think you are familiar with as a sampled and held signal. That is, you take a continuous time signal, you look at its values at discrete instants of time, usually uniformly spaced. And between those sampling instants, you hold the value to be constant. Okay, so that's what is known as a sampled and held signal. And a circuit that takes a continuous time signal and gives you the sampled and held signal is known as a sample and hold circuit. Okay, so that's what we were discussing. And in principle, this is a very easy circuit because we have switches. All you have to do is to allow the input signal for a certain period of time and then block the input signal for another period of time, during which you store the last sampled voltage on the capacitor. Okay. So we have Vi, the switch periodically operated by a signal S and a holding capacitor C. So, if S is like that and Vi could be anything, so clearly the output signal Vo here will be tracking this here, and then here it does not change, then here it tracks, here it does not change. Here it tracks, does not change, and so on. Okay. So, this particular circuit is known as a track and hold because it alternately tracks the input signal and holds it in the holds it when the switch is off. Okay. So, it turns out this is the building block of every sample and hold. And we do it this way because in reality the switch will have some resistance, the input voltage source will not be perfect. So, when you turn on the switch, it is not as though instantly V naught will become equal to Vi. With an ideal switch it will, but in reality it does not. So, you have to allow some room for tracking. What really happens is in the tracking phase, it does not jump from here to there. So, usually it takes some time and goes that way and then finally starts tracking the signal. It is just the natural response of its own circuit. Okay. So, typical thing and most convenient thing is to allow, if you have a clock, half the period for tracking and half the period for holding. Okay. Now, what we really wanted was to have not this, but something like this, where samples here, holds it, samples here, holds it all the way there, samples there, holds it, and so on. Okay. And that can be easily done, as many of you suggested yesterday. One way is of course to make the tracking window very small, but then the problem is it may not track at all, right, because of it takes some time, the circuit will have some bandwidth, and if you have a very short time, this voltage will not track that voltage. So, instead what you typically do, if you need the sampled and held signal, by the way, many times this is also okay having this track and hold. There are applications where you just have one of them and you just look at the signal only when S is 0, okay, then it is a discrete time signal. But there are applications where you do need a sample and hold, and the way to implement that is also quite easy. You need a buffer here and this is S and this is S bar. Okay. And practical implementation, like you would have done in the lab for DC-DC converters and so on, there has to be a certain amount of overlap or non-overlap between these, and you have to take care of all that stuff. But for now, with ideal switching signals, I'll say S and S bar. And what happens is that the second track and hold in its tracking phase is tracking the held signal. So the output is a constant, and when it is holding, the output is obviously a constant. So the output will look something like this, okay. A cascade of two track and holds is a sample and hold. Have you studied sampled and held signals in signals and systems? What does its Fourier transform look like? Do you know? No? Did you ever look at this? I mean, impulse sampled signals, I am sure you have seen, but the sampled and held signal, have you seen? No. Okay, what do you think is the relationship between the impulse sampled signal and the sampled and held signal? How do you get the sampled and held signal from the impulse sampled signal? Convolve with a pulse, perfect, okay. So the signal model would be, again, this is not something that we would do in detail. First you multiply with an impulse train, TS is the sampling interval. So here we will get, this is the continuous time signal, and here I get XS of T, which is basically XE of KTS, okay. And if you pass it through a filter whose impulse response is just a pulse, okay, so that means that the impulse response of this H of T is a pulse that lasts from 0 to TS. So what happens is, every one of these impulses gives you a rectangular pulse, okay, and the weight of the rectangular pulse is the weight of the signal, and that is exactly what we have, right. So you can think of constructing the sampled and held signal as, first you sample, then you generate these pulses. I am drawing these vertical lines to distinguish pulses generated by each one, but I mean it just jumps from here to there and there and so on, okay. So here we can call this XSH of T, which is a sampled and held version of this. It is also called a zero order held version. There are different orders of hold, okay. So instead of this pulse, if you have a triangular pulse, you will get a first order hold and so on, okay. But we do not have to consider any of those things. This zero order hold is what we have, and this circuit, assuming switches are operating ideally, gives you XSH of T, where this is X of T, okay. This is fine. So is the sampled and held signal a perfect representation of the input signal XE? Is the impulse sampled signal a perfect representation of the input signal XE? Yes or no? I mean, assuming it is band limited, of course. Yes. Okay. How do you get back the continuous time signal from the impulse sampled signal? Yeah, you apply a brick wall filter of what bandwidth? So for this particular signal, the sampling interval is TS. So what is the bandwidth of brick wall filter you would apply to get back XE of T from XS of T? 2 by TS. No, no, I am looking for the bandwidth in hertz, okay. 1 by 2 TS, right. It is 1 by 2 TS because the copies of the signal, if you recall, will be generated at 0, 1 by TS, 2 by TS and so on. You have to cut off everything above 1 by 2 TS. Everything above half the sampling rate will be aliased back to the main, I mean DC, right. Now the sampled and held signal, is it, how do you get the input signal back from the sampled and held signal? Can you get that? I mean, presumably you can, but how do you do that? Let's say the Fourier transform of Xc of t is Xc of f. And I am not showing the negative frequency axis, of course it is there. Let us say it is something like that, okay, and it clearly satisfies the Nyquist criterion for sampling because the bandwidth is below half the sampling rate. This is the sampling rate, right? Fs equals 1 by Ts. This is Fn hertz. What will be the Fourier transform of the impulse sample signal? It is exactly the same shape copied over to, okay, this is not a great drawing, but you know what I mean. And as you said, if you apply a filter like that, you can get it out, okay, you can get the original signal. What will this be? What is the relationship between this and that? XS and XSH. What happens? Multiply by the spectrum is multiplied by the sink.
Basically,
you are filtering it, right? Filtering it with an impulse response. The impulse response is a pulse. So, the filter's frequency response is a sink. And what does the sink look like on this? Where are the nulls of the sink? Huh? Where are the nulls of the sink? Fourier transform of a pulse, what does the sink look like? What is the Fourier transform of a rectangular pulse? Yeah, so where are the, what does that look like in the, if I sketch it on the frequency axis? Decaying sinusoid. Yeah, okay. It go, what, at what, does it goes to 0 at any frequency? No? Ah, yes. So, at what frequency does it go to 0? Calculate it, right? What is the difficulty here? You must have learned some notation to represent a pulse of this type, right? What is it? How do you, I mean, there is some shorthand notation for this. What is that? Huh? Rect. What is inside? T? T by? Really? T by Ts, that is it. Rect, basically rect of T by Ts is this, okay. So, this corresponds to that one. What is the Fourier transform of this? What's the Fourier transform of rect of T by TS? Sync. Okay, fine. What is crucial is what's in the bracket and what's before it. This I assume is 1. Okay. What is the multiplier? What is multiplying the sink? Huh? TS. Yeah, I told you, right? It's the area. So if the amplitude is 1 and width is TS, the area is TS. And then what is inside the sink? Of course, it will have F. It's a function of frequency. What else does it have? F times TS. Yeah, it's the width of the pulse. And for this, there will all be an additional factor. What is that? What is it? This is the Fourier transform of this. What's the Fourier transform of that one? Or if you delay a signal by something, what happens to the Fourier transform? Gets multiplied by. Anyway, this is actually quite irrelevant to what we are discussing, but I wanted to mention it. So this is what happens. So J pi FTS. Okay, it's delayed by TS by 2. So you have a linear phase corresponding to that delay. So anyway, if you just look at the magnitude, what happens is that it is like you take the impulse sample signal and you are multiplying it by. That's the absolute value of the sink, right? So it goes to 0 at integer multiples of 1 by TS. The sink goes to 0 whenever the argument is an integer, right? Except 0, of course, 1, 2, 3, and so on. So the argument is F times TS. So when F times TS is 1, 2, 3, etcetera, it goes to 0. So it goes there. So what happens is this sampled and held signal, there is a slight low pass filtering. You can see that higher frequencies are slightly attenuated. If you want to reconstruct it, you have to boost it up and reconstruct. Okay. If you just filter it, what you get will be a slight low pass filtered version of the original signal. Okay. And anyway, this is just some information, not really directly related to our circuit design right now. Okay. So that's all that's there to it. I mean, at least that is the there is a lot of circuit detail when it comes to designing sample and holds. There are lots of non-ideal features and so on. We won't go into any of that, but this is the basic topology of the sample and hold. You have a switch and a capacitor, and you have two of them operating in opposite phases, you get a sample and hold. Okay. Now, I think you can at least at a high level guess the requirements. Let's say this has some resistance RS and this has some switch resistance RSW. Then clearly, what is the requirement? How would you place a constraint on these things? What is the constraint? Tell me. Should be? Yeah. So, RS plus RSW times C, this is the time constant of the circuit, should be much smaller than the tracking of the holding period, let us say TS by 2 or so. Okay. I am assuming that you will be sampling a band limited signal. Okay. Otherwise, you will have some difficulty tracking as well. So, as long as you ensure this, you will have some sample and hold effect. It does not have to in reality jump from this to that directly. It can take some time, but as long as it takes some time and completely settles, it is fine. Okay. So, the output of this is still a continuous time signal, but the value of the continuous time signal depends only on sampled values of the original input signal. Okay. Any questions here about the sample and hold? There are many implementations of this. I am not sure, I think here it does not probably does not make sense to discuss them, but there are sample and holds using transistors, using op amps and so on. So, but we won't worry about those things. Okay. Any questions about this? So sampling, which is an integral part of any modern analog signal processing system, it's done like this. In somewhere or the other, you will have a switch somewhere, and you will have a capacitor that is holding the sampled values. Okay. And you also know the spectrum of the sampled and held signal, and if for some reason you have to reconstruct the original signal from this, then you know what to do. You have to boost it up a little bit because there is some low pass filtering because of sin x by x sync, right? But that has to be boosted up. And actually there is a block known as the digital to analog converter, means that you feed in discrete samples, and it gives you a continuous time output signal, and the kind of signal that gives is exactly like this. It is a sampled and held signal, right? What it does is it takes the input samples, which are really defined in discrete time, they are stored in a digital register somewhere, and it takes it out and gives you a waveform which is constant over one period, and that constant value is proportional to the input sample. Okay, and from that, if you want the continuous time signal, you need to build what is known as a reconstruction filter, and this is what it is. Reconstruction filter is a combination of, first of all, to go from discrete to continuous time, you need this brick wall. You also have to undo the effect of this attenuation, so you need to have a filter that looks like that, whose response is the inverse of the sync, and then also it cuts off everything beyond fs by 2 or 1 by 2 ts. Is this okay? Yeah, I mean, not with circuits, I mean not with analog circuits, it's quite difficult. This is very easy, but to have a linear interpolation between samples is a lot more difficult. So typically we don't use that. I mean, I'm sure you can come up with some circuit like that, but for operating at the highest speed, this track and hold circuit is the best. So that's what we'll use. Any other question? Okay, so now that we have sampled the signal, we also have to digitize it. That is, we have to essentially, now we have sampled it, meaning we are looking at the signal at only discrete instants of time, and when we say we digitize it, we also round it off, right? That is, we try to represent it with a finite number of levels. Although this is now sampled, the sample value is continuous, right? Even if you confine a signal to a 1 volt range, the number of possible values is still infinite, because every voltage between 0 and 1 volt has to be represented. Okay. Not linear interpolation. What you need is ideally to go from impulse sample to this, what is the kind of interpolation you need? Sync interpolation, right? Now that's what you do. So if you had this brick wall filter, if you realize an impulse response corresponding to that, a brick wall filter, that is sync interpolation. Okay, and to go from sampled and held to that, you need the inverse sync because of the distortion. This is in the frequency domain, the other sync is in the time domain, so don't get confused. So basically what you have to do is to implement this. Okay, the interpolation function is whatever is the inverse Fourier transform of that. Okay, anything else? So we have sampling, and we also need to do quantization to complete the process of analog to digital conversion, or typically it is abbreviated to A to D conversion. Okay. So essentially you have to, the quantization is rounding off, that's all. So that you say that, hey, all signals between 0 and 100 millivolts correspond to logic 0, and then the next one to 1 and next one to 2 and so on. Okay. You can have as many or as few levels as you want, but essentially the mapping of a continuous set of levels to a discrete set of levels, that is quantization. Okay. So how would you go about doing this? How will you make, how will you quantize? Let's assume that the input signal lies between 0 and 1 volt. I mean, every circuit will have some limitation. We will spec our A to D converter, our circuit, that the input signal always lies between 0 and 1 volt, okay. And the number of levels of quantization can be anything. If you have 3 bit ADC, that means that you have divided the 0 to 1 volt range into 8 pieces and you look at which range the input signal is in and give a corresponding digital number, okay. You can have 3 bits or 13 bits, in which case you will have 8192 levels and so on, okay. So, but how will we do this? Comparators, what? Comparators, okay. Have you seen the architecture somewhere? Of how to make the analog to digital converter? How do you do that? How do you do that? Yeah, so one way or the other, there are different classes of A to D converters, but one particular class, which is what we will discuss here. One way or the other, you have to take the input signal and compare it to every possible quantization level, okay. So, before we go there, let me just discuss the characteristics of the A to D converter. I will assume that the input voltage consists only of positive values and the output is a digital number, okay. So, the output can only have discrete levels. So, let us say one possibility, there are many ways of having this characteristic, but let us say this is how I have it. One possibility is to say that so between, so if this is 1 volt and I have taken a 3 bit ADC, which means that there are 8 regions the reference voltage is divided into, okay. If it is between 0 and 1/8 of a volt, between 0 and 125 millivolt, I will say that the output code is 0, okay. And between 1/8 and 1/4, it is 1 and so on. And it does not stop there, if you go beyond 1 volt, the output will remain at 7, it cannot give you an output beyond 7. And if the input goes below 0 volts, it goes negative, it will continue to be 0. So, this is what the characteristic of an A to D converter will look like. What does it resemble? It resembles the characteristic of some other block that you would have used. What is it? It is a more generalized comparator, right? A comparator is a what? Is a comparator an A to D converter? It is a 1 bit A to D converter, right. Comparator only decides whether it is above or below a certain value. So, that means it has just 1 bit of information, okay. So, now this is more a generalized comparator, it is it has more fine grained estimation of where the input signal is. So, this is a 3 bit ADC, okay. So, the characteristic of every ADC will look like this. Of course, the details will be different, that is the input could consist of the input range here. From 0 to 1 volt, this is all positive. It could consist of only negative values or positive and negative values symmetrically placed, etcetera. And the representation of the output digits can also be different, okay. Instead of saying 1, 2, 3, 4, you could start from minus 3 and so on. But the characteristic of every A to D converter in general looks like this, okay. So, you will have some saturation and after that there will be some equally divided ranges, and you give equally, I mean, you give output digits corresponding to which range the input is in, and finally at the higher level also it goes and saturates. Okay. So by looking at the output digit, you have an approximate idea of where the input is. If you know that if the output digit is 3, you know that it's going to be between 3/8 and half a volt. Okay. What errors? Yeah, yeah. So that I mean, probably we won't get into here. Essentially, what defines the A to D characteristic are these transition points, right? So an n bit n level. So this is 3-bit converter. So that means an 8-level ADC. This has 7 transition points, right? And what is the transition point? That is the voltage at which the output changes from one digital code to the next. Okay. So if it is just below the transition point, you get some output code, and if it is just above the transition point, it gets you get a different digital code. Okay. So if you have n levels, you will have n minus 1 transition points, and that's all you need to describe the A to D converter. Okay. The definition of the output digits and so on, that's all trivial, but you understand this, right? Basically, to specify an n level A to D converter, you need to specify n minus 1 values. Okay. So now I think what you are pointing out is that these transition levels will not be equally spaced, will not be exactly equal to 1/8 the spacing and so on. So that is there. So that is going to happen in reality, and you measure the errors in the transition levels by measuring the A to D characteristic and specify that. Okay. So we will probably not get into that, but yeah, essentially when you specify an A to D, this is an ideal A to D converter. I mean, similar to the ideal op amp, etc., which exist only in mythology. So in reality, the transition points will be different from these, and the A to D data sheet will tell you how much different they can be, the maximum value of deviation from the ideal transition values. Okay. So if there is time, we will discuss that. The deviations, there are mainly two characteristics that deal with that. They are known as DNL and INL. Basically, differential nonlinearity and integral nonlinearity. Okay. Essentially, what they measure is, again, I will discuss it later in detail if we have time. The differential nonlinearity measures how wide each step is compared to the ideal width, and the integral nonlinearity measures the error between where the step is and where the step should be. Okay. So again, you can see that, and it's called nonlinearity because if the transition levels are not uniformly spaced, the characteristic is nonlinear. What is, I mean, first of all, this whole thing is nonlinear. In fact, it's horribly nonlinear, right? It has the step-like characteristics. But what is the here linearity refers to whether the transition levels are equally spaced or not. Okay. If they're not equally spaced, it is nonlinear. Is it okay? So, but let's stick to the ideal characteristics. It's basically like a comparator, but you have more fine-grained comparison. You also specify which of the 8 ranges the input is in. How would you implement a circuit which gives you this? I think I already got some answers. What do you do? What do you do? Yeah, essentially what you have to do is you have to compare with every one of these values, right? You have these transition levels, 125 millivolts, 250 millivolts and so on. Okay. You compare with every one of those, and then it is easy to figure out which range it is in. Okay. Where have you seen this? Digital system. Okay, fine. So these are not op amps, these are comparators. Okay. This is VI, and here you compare VI with 7/8 volts. If VI happens to be more than that, this will be 1, and you know that it is in the uppermost range, and so on. Okay. The very last one here you compare with 1/8 of a volt, and if it is below that, you know that it is in the lowermost range, etcetera. Okay. And how do you generate these levels? It is sort of obvious that you have n resistors, and this voltage I call it V ref, or the full scale, basically that is equal to this voltage, right? 1 volt. You divide that into 8 parts by having 8 equal resistors. Okay. So clearly, if the resistors are equal, you get these equally spaced voltages, and that's it. Okay. This is fine. You have seen this before. What do you do with the comparator outputs? You have to have an encoder, because this is a redundant code. You have 7 wires, basically 7 bits representing 7 levels, but that is very inefficient, right, to represent, sorry, 8 levels represented by 7 wires. You want to represent them using 3 wires. So, it goes into some encoder. Again, I won't discuss this. I think all this has been done in it gives you 3 bits. Okay. This is fine. So, any problems with this that you foresee? Do you know how many, so if you have the audio, like you have the mic input of your mobile phone and so on, right? So, you have audio analog to digital converter, it takes your audio and converts it to digital. How many bits does it have, do you know? 16 plus, right? 16 bits. The standard CD audio would be 16 bits, and also within the radio of the mobile phone there will be many A to D converters which are of the order of 12 to 14 bits. Okay. So, can we make those using the same architecture? Yes or no? Why not? Yeah. So, for 16 bits you need 65,000 comparators. That is simply not feasible at all. Okay. And even, I mean, this kind of architecture, I would say up to 6 or 7 bits, that is 64 or maybe 128 comparators you can use. The only virtue of this architecture is that it is instantaneous, that is you make all the comparisons simultaneously. So, in one shot you get the result. Okay. But you cannot have too many comparators, you cannot have very high resolution. The number of bits is basically the resolution, right? How many levels you resolve it into. So, this is used only in high speed, and I will call it low resolution, which means that basically small number of levels or small number of bits. Okay. So, typically less than 7 bits for sure. But I mean, this kind of A to D converter is capable of the highest possible speeds. There are A to D converters working at 50 gigasamps per second using, or maybe tens of gigasamps per second using this. Okay. Any ideas how we could do better? Certainly, we can't have, essentially the number of comparators goes exponentially with the number of bits, right? Because the number of levels is 2 raised to the number of bits minus 1, the number of transition points, and you need that many comparators. Okay. So, how can we do the same, how can we have the same result, that is the same kind of comparison, but not use as much hardware? What are the things we can use? So, we will use clock then. So, you are saying you will, how many comparators will you have? Just one. Yeah. So, you will have one comparator. First, I will compare with the lowest level and next with the highest, next highest level and so on. You go through all the levels and essentially, and after each step, you store the result of the comparison. Okay. So, with one comparator also you can do it. What is the disadvantage of this? It takes time, that is all. It takes as many number of clock cycles as you would have the number of comparators here, but that is maybe a reasonable trade off. But can we do something more intelligent than that? Yeah. That is exactly. So, it is the same thing, we do a sequential thing, but we do not do a sequential search, we do a binary search, right. We compare it with the midpoint first. Once you do that, you can eliminate half the comparisons, right. And then you, let us say it is in the upper half, then you compare it with the midpoint of that range. Okay. Exactly how you would look for words in a dictionary or something, you look at the middle and then this way and that way and so on, unless there are tabs which show you which letter it is. Right? So, the binary search is a very common thing, isn't it? You use it all the time. So, essentially instead of 2 to the n minus 1 comparisons, you need how many comparisons? For an n bit A to D converter, how many comparisons will we need? How many? Log? For n bits, how many? For n bits, how many transition levels do I have? 2 to the? I hear all kinds of linear and nonlinear functions of n, but what's that? For n bits, we have 2 to the n minus 1 comparators. Okay. Now, we want to do the same comparison using binary search. How many steps will we need? N, right? N, that's all. To divide a range into 2 to the n subranges, every comparison will divide it by half. Okay. So, with n comparisons, you can divide it by 2 to the n, that is all. Okay. So, for the our particular case, in the first comparison, you decide whether it is in the upper 500 millivolts or lower 500 millivolts. The next comparison, in each range, you see whether it is in the upper 250 millivolts or the lower 250 millivolts. And in the third comparison, you see whether it is in the upper 125 millivolts or lower 125 millivolts, and you are done. Right. So, for n bits, you need n comparisons when you do this in binary search. Log n. I think you are thinking of number of levels. The number of levels is 2 to the n and log of that is n. Okay. So, this is I think if I write out the description of this, it looks very complicated, although I am sure you understand what is going on quite easily. So, you decide where it is. So, let us say the input voltage is somewhere here. In step number 1, you simply decide that it is in the upper or lower half. And depending on that, you modify step number 2. Because you determined that it is in the upper half, you use only this range and you compare it with this one. This is the comparison level in the first step. This is the comparison level in the second step. And that is telling you that it is in the lower half of the upper range. So, then you focus only on the range that it is in step 3, and you compare it with this, which is 5 V rev by 8. Okay. So this is the comparison level in the third step. So from the first step you learned that it's in the upper half. If it's in the upper half, the digit is a 1, in the lower half the digit is a 0. The second comparison, you determine that it's in the lower half, so it is 0, and in the third one you have determined that it's in the upper half, it is 1. So what is the decimal equivalent of this binary number? 5. And as you can see, the number was in, this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that's the correct answer, right. So the binary digit that you get as a result of successive comparisons, that is the right answer. I mean, that's the binary representation and it gives you that directly. Is this okay? So this binary search is also a very common way of implementing analog to digital conversion, okay. So what it does is it reduces the number of comparators drastically. Exactly how many comparators we will use depends on some architectures. We will discuss one particular flavor of this binary search type of A to D converter. There are lots of them. The main advantage is you don't have thousands of comparators, right? You have a few at most. I mean, in fact, you can do it with one also. The price that you pay is, instead of doing it in one shot, one step, you will have n steps. But still the advantage is enormous, right? Because let's say you had a 10-bit A to D converter. If you realize the other type of A to D converter, by the way, the name for this, you know, it is known as a flash A to D converter for obvious reason. So if you make a flash A to D converter, you need more than 1000 comparators and it does it in one step, okay. And if you use the binary search, you will use one comparator and how many steps? 10 steps, okay. So the number of steps has gone by only factor of 10. So it is still like a very good trade off. So very advantageous architecture, so that's what it is used, okay. And within that binary search, there are many implementation differences. We will look at one particular implementation, okay. The comparator has got nothing to do with whether you do binary search or not. All you have to do is, you have one comparator. In the first step, you configure it like this. You have to, should have VI and VREF by 2, or in fact, in a more general way, I will show the single input. The input should be VI minus VREF by 2, and in the second step, in first step, it should basically decide on VI minus VREF by 2. In the second step, it should decide on what? VI minus this bit, let me call it B2 times VREF by 2. If it is 1, that will be there. If it is 0, that will go away, minus VREF by 4, right. So if B2 is 1, it will compare with 3 VREF by 4. If it is 0, it will compare with VREF by 4. And in step number 3, it will compare with VI minus B1 VREF by 2 minus B2. So this will give you, the result of this comparison will give you B1, the result will give you B2. So it is dependent on the previous ones, that is why we carry out the step sequentially, right. Minus B2 times VREF by 4, and this gives you B3, okay. So all you have, the comparator is the same, you have to arrange the inputs appropriately, that is all. Yeah, that we will see how to make that. There are many ways to do that, we will see how to do that. Okay. I mean, you can also think about, I mean, arrangements which will give you this VI minus VREF by 2. So if you look at all these different architectures, again at a conceptual level, I am not talking about, when you get into the transistor level and start discussing how fast will this work versus how fast will that work and how well will this work in this technology, there will be all kinds of differences. But conceptually, every one of those binary search converters will be doing exactly this. So they will be comparing in consecutive steps the result of this comparison, this one and this one, and you can go further, okay. And the input to the comparator can be this or some scaled version of this, that is also fine, right. So if you multiply this by from factor alpha and compare, you will still get the same result because that comparator is a 1-bit comparator. So conceptually, the difference between different types of these binary search converters is just that, what goes into the comparator, okay. Anyway, you can also think of like how to do this efficiently, right. Any questions about this? So we have discussed the sample and hold at a high level. So by using a cascade of switches and capacitors, you will get cascade of track and holds, you will get a sample and hold, and you also know I think what the output spectrum looks like if you want to reconstruct it, how it should be and things like that. And we have to quantize the sample signal. One way you already know, that is simultaneous comparison with all possible transition levels, but that is very inefficient in hardware. So binary search is preferred, I would say, in most of the cases. And now you, I think, understand the idea of binary search. You keep looking at successive half sub ranges, right? You have the full range, you look at whether it is upper or lower half, and then once you decide that, within that range you look for upper and lower and so on. And in n comparisons, you would have narrowed down the signal to 1 part in 2 to the n, okay. Now how to implement this in circuit, there is a variety of possibilities, we will discuss one such thing in the course.